Warning, Serena will not be taking responsibility for any unplanned pregnancy, so sew at your own risk. However, should you become willfully unemployed and your bills still paid and your partner needs someone to thank, send them my way.
Hello, my loves, and welcome back to my channel. My name is Serena, and in today's video, we're going to be making a 1960s baby doll nylon set, more like the nylon chiffon, like very airy and sheer version of said set. I've been wanting sets like these for a really long time, and the only way that they're kind of affordable is if they are damaged or the set is incomplete. And usually when they are a complete set, they cost a little bit more or a lot more. And so they're definitely worth it if you struggle with sewing sheer fabrics. I, on the other hand, don't have that much of a problem with it anymore, so I think it's worth the effort to get exactly what it is that I want. I want to say that this project was inspired by a reel that I saw on Instagram where it was this creator who was wearing like muumuus and like really long night sets, saying that those were the outfits that kept your grandma or her grandma pregnant and her bills paid. And it was meant to be a joke, obviously not literally, although it did apply to some people's homes. But it had me thinking that one, probably not necessarily, because I feel like those are the outfits that grandmothers wear now. Like those are house dresses that grandmothers wear now. But when they were in their prime, what were they wearing? And then I pulled up a couple ads and stuff like that, and it was most certainly those sheer chiffon baby doll sets. And I would even go as far to say as mine is a little bit more modest than the ones that they were wearing. So I thought it was a pretty funny video, and I just wanted to go ahead and kind of like put my spin on it. The outfit that I think that would get the grandma's bills paid, you know? Without further ado, let's get into the materials as well as the video. I hope you guys enjoy this. I want to say a special thank you to my patrons who actually requested that I make this video after showing them my muslin of this outfit. So thank you guys so much. If you'd like to become a patron, go ahead and click the link below. You can give me a virtual tip over on Ko-fi. All support is super, super helpful and appreciated. Like and subscribe. That's still one of the most beneficial ways to support this channel for free. So thank you. Now let's get to it.
I want to talk about the type of pattern that you could use. I think any pattern with a yoke is perfect for this. So on the left, you'll have Simplicity 1553 and it has a square yoke. And then on the right, the one I'm going to be using is McCall 6242 and that has a rounded yoke. I will be just using the nighty pattern and disregard the duster because I'll be using the nighty to make both the robe and the nightgown. This is a very common style pattern, so I want to focus more on the style so that way you can find any pattern, whether it's in your stash or online, to make this. You'll follow the exact same steps as the one that I use. You don't have to have the exact same pattern. If you'd like to see me make the McCall's version in full, in a non-sheer fabric, then you can watch my Christmas video, which I'll link above.
So I am using 100% nylon, as stated earlier, and this isn't the easiest things to get your hand on, especially in the quality that you're going to need. So usually I have a shopping list for my bobbins on Patreon, but I'm gonna go ahead and share with you guys here. This is from Joanne Fabric. It's their Casa collection, which is their special occasion slash bridal collection. It doesn't come in a whole lot of colors, and my store only had three colors, so I picked it up in white the first time and I think ivory this time, and just dyed it to the color that I want. In order to make the trim on my outfit, which you want to do first, I cut 2-inch wide strips the length of my fabric, and I bought 5 yards of fabric, and so I did that 5 times, and that gave me all of the trim that I would need.
Once all of your trim is cut, you should have a big old stack just like this. And then I use my ruffler foot attachment. I show you how to attach this to your machine in my simple overskirt tutorial. I'll also link that. And then you just want to center your strips of fabric and then let the ruffler foot do what it does, gather it. Once you get close to the end of a strip, then you just overlay, you put the next strip on top, and then just run it right underneath the gathering foot and it'll gather it. and I continue to do this until I have a long continuous strip of trim. If you do not have the ruffler foot or attachment, you can still absolutely do this by hand, and you can do it in such a way that does not require you to do a very long basting stitch and just pull it and gather it down. You can actually kind of create the pleats as you allow your sewing machine to stitch, and then you can use the long gathering tail to kind of get the fullness that you want. And I'm going to pop in a clip on how to do that really quickly. As you can see in my example, it's already pretty gathered by doing it by hand, and then I just gently tug on the gathering thread to adjust how full I want the gathers to be. Once the ruffles are out of the way, it's time to proceed as relatively usual. I am using the yoke pattern and I'm draping it on my dress form to kind of tissue fit it and get an idea of how low I want the yoke to sit on my body. I have narrow shoulders, so I do have to account for that, so that way it sits nicely. The nightgown will be made exactly the way that the pattern suggests, so we're mainly going to go into detail and focus on the robe. The center back is going to be cut on the fold, and the center front needs to be cut in two pieces down the center front, so that way it can tie in the front. So make sure you allot for enough seam allowance for that to be the case, so it meets evenly in the middle. Once I'm comfortable with where the yoke sits, then I fold back the extra bits of the yoke, and then I add 1/4 inch of a seam allowance for the center front. And keep in mind, you can also put in 5/8 of seam allowance, so that way you don't forget as you're sewing, but I'm not going to forget, so I use a very narrow seam allowance for the front of this yoke. I am working on cutting out the front of the robe now, and I also don't want to cut this on the fold, and make sure that I leave enough room in the center front for there to be seam allowance for a hem. I am also going to shorten this pattern and make it 25 inches long, not counting the yoke. So just the body of the coat is going to be 25 inches long. And I'm not worrying about hemming this because I'm going to be adding a ruffle at the bottom, but you might want to consider that if you plan on hemming it. Now I'm cutting the back of the robe. It's cut on the fold, and then I do make a slight adjustment for the armhole. I don't cut it as deep because my bust isn't very big, so it kind of just hangs oddly or too low. And once that's all cut out, it's time to move to the sewing machine. To start, you want to start sewing down the side seams of the front and back of the robe. So I am using French seams for this. I highly recommend French seams for sheer fabrics because you can see right through it. For thin and sheer fabrics, use a Microtex needle, reduce your top tension, and use your smallest stitch so that way the machine doesn't chew up your fabric. Also, if you find that the machine's trying to pull your fabric down to the bobbin, you can always use some tissue paper or tear away stabilizer to help with this. Reducing your tension is really important because it will keep the fabric from gathering. Also, the tighter stitch will stop that as well. Once the side seams on the body of the robe is complete, then I move on to the yoke pieces and I sew up the side seams on that as well. On the yoke of the robe, if you're going to put a ruffle trim, you do not need to do French seams because the trim is going to cover that up. So go ahead and just sew that up with a regular 5/8 seam allowance, and you will be good. The yoke pieces should have been cut twice each, and you should have 4 pieces, so that way you have a front and a lining, and then you want to combine the front and the lining of the yoke pieces around the neckline and down the center front and leave the loose notched ends open. Trim down your seam allowance and set it aside as we move back to the body of the robe. This is the side seam and the armhole, and you're going to need to cut some bias tape. I kind of outlined that with my finger. It's really hard to see, but you're gonna wanna cut some bias tape and you're gonna sew that down 1/4 inch according to my instructions, and just close up that raw edge with bias tape, which I am doing now. Once the armholes are covered with bias tape, now you can decide whether or not you want to hem the center front. And I decided to hem it because I think it will look so much neater. But I'm doing this by hand and I'm doing a rolled hem. So here I'm showing you, first you want to fold down 1/4 inch, and then you're going to sew like demonstrated, and when you pull it, it should roll the hem over and it looks so nice. This can be done by serger if you have one, and you can do a narrow hem with a narrow hem foot on your sewing machine or a standard sewing machine as long as you have the narrow hem foot. I really like the way it looks by hand, so that's what I do. After your hem is put in, it's time to fold over the seam allowances on both the lining and the main fabric of the yoke. Do that 5/8 of a seam allowance. You do not need to trim this down because, again, you will be covering this with the ruffle on the robe. On the nightgown, you're going to want to trim it if you actually care about the way that it looks. If you don't trim it down, you will be able to see the raw edges and the seam allowance on the inside of the nightgown, but on the robe it doesn't matter, so just sew as usual. So I put some gathering stitches into the robe, and now I am sewing it right sides together to the yoke of the robe. This may be a little difficult to see, but at this point my hack is complete, so you can just follow the directions that you have on your instructions. And if you want to follow along to this pattern exactly, again, I did use this pattern in its entirety for my Christmas outfit or Christmas pajamas last year, so you can watch that video. I make it in a flannel and you'll be able to see all of the steps in a more visible way. This is a little bit difficult, I understand. So now that it's fully attached, I am sewing down the lining with a top stitch all the way around the robe, and I'm doing this as close to the edge of the fabric as possible. And if you don't get this perfectly straight, that's fine because the trim will go over the top of it, but I do recommend that you do this as straight as possible because practice is practice. So if you do it this way, then you have good practice for the next time. And this is what the robe looks like on the mannequin without the closures and without the ruffles. I think it's really nice. The rolled hem looks beautiful, and it's time to start the next step. The first time I made this, I made each individual ruffle at a time, so it was like one layer at a time because I was unsure how much ruffles that I needed to make. This time I just went ahead and made a bulk amount of ruffles because I figured whatever I got left over I would use to trim out the bottom of it. That worked out really quickly, and because I did it that way, this one was even quicker to make than the first one. This was done all in one day. Now that we've gotten to the end of the first ruffle, you want to cut it with enough seam allowance that you can fold it back on itself and then sew over the top. So that is what I'm demonstrating here. I just fold it over, lay it flat, and then sew on top. And then you get a clean finish at the edge, and you don't have like weird cut edges, and you don't have to worry about your stitch coming loose later. We are on one of the last rows. I did 6 rows of these ruffles, and basically I just wanted to cover up that yoke completely so it's nice and fluffy and you don't see any spaces. I eyeballed the gap between the two. I think the gap is about 1/2 inch to 1/4 inch between the two sets of ruffles, and you just want to be careful not to sew over the top of the ruffle from before. So you can pin that down or just be careful to move your fingers to hold the last row of ruffles out of the way as you sew the next one. Now I am trimming out the bottom of the robe with one ruffle, and I do go back later on and add a second ruffle because I had extra and I wanted to use it all up since I did put forth the effort to make it. If you made it this far and you're enjoying this video, don't forget to like and hit that subscribe button. I'd love to keep you around. But I also want to notify you that this is the part where the robe is complete, and then I just jumped to the lining portion of the nightgown because it was quite difficult to see, so I didn't think that filming another invisible garment was going to make much sense, but to stick to the parts where I altered the pattern. And in this case, the only thing that I did to the nightie that I didn't do to the Christmas version of this was sew a lining on, which is what I'm showing you now. Sewing wrong side of the lining to the right side of the main fabric, I am sewing the underarms first. the two pieces are put together at the side seams already. So instead of putting a bias tape on this, I am just going to create a seam using the lining and the main fabric of the nightie. And I'm going to do a French seam here. That's why we do wrong side to right side. And since it's only a quarter of an inch seam allowance for underneath the arm, I am really playing with fire. So be very, very careful when sewing this that your sewing machine does not eat this up, because you do not have a whole lot of seam allowance. Once I turn the lining to the inside, I top stitch with a quarter inch seam allowance. And after this, you follow the instructions as normal. Once the lining is on the inside, you treat this entire piece as though it were one piece, and you gather the top edge down to fit the yoke, and you put that on. As you can tell, the nylon is still white, but the lining was dyed rose quartz pink, and I was almost going to leave it this way because it had a very eerie, enchanting look, but then I decided that it would be easier to keep it looking stain free if it were all pink, so I went ahead and dyed it after this. The nightgown is quite plain, and I really didn't like this about the muslin that I made, and I know I'm not going to be satisfied with this one, so I wanted to kind of spice it up a bit. So I grabbed the Janome S9 and do a decorative stitch, like a leaf stitch, around the top of the yoke, and then I add like a decorative little floral rosette to it, so that way it can, like, I don't know, liven it up a bit. I know that the showstopper is supposed to be the robe, and I kind of wanted the inside to be very simple so that way I have a good fresh base for it, but I couldn't leave well enough alone, so I had to do something to it. Initially, I tried to do some smocking for the yoke of this, but that failed. It was tragic. I spent almost an entire day smocking, and it wasn't enough fabric to make up the entire thing. So here is the embroidery done. Well, this was a decorative stitch, and then I was playing with some trim that I'm not actually going to use, but I thought it was cool that if you lay the trim on top, then it looks like the leaves are attached to it. I thought that was cool. So now it's time for the reveal. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. I hope you found it helpful. And I really do hope that you guys make this and tag me in your make so I can see how you bring one of these baby doll dresses, nightgowns to life. I used satin ribbon and two hook and eyes on the yoke to hold the robe together in the front. If you'd like to support this channel any further, you can leave me a virtual tip over on Ko-fi, where you can become a Bobbin over on Patreon for exclusive content and sneak peeks. I just released some new merch in my Etsy shop, which will also be linked below. Let me know what you think of this set. Did I nail a more realistic look for the time, or do you think that the first muumuu was more fitting for the occasion?